Bishop Bartchak, the Saint Vincent community honors you today for your distinguished leadership and humble service to the Diocese of Altoona-Johnstown, to the Catholic Church in the United States, and to the Universal Church. As a priest and a renowned scholar and practitioner of canon law, you have brought the saving message of the gospel for 30 years to congregations and to classrooms. And as the bishop of the Diocese of Altoona-Johnstown, you have represented the people of your diocese at the local, national, and international levels, always striving to let the joy of the gospel of Christ shine forth for all. Earned your licentiate and doctorate in canon law with distinction at the Catholic University of America before returning to Erie to work as a canonist and spiritual director at St. Mark Seminary. Your ministry to the church in Erie culminated in your tenure as vicar for canonical affairs of the diocese. On the national and international level, among many other accomplishments, you served as president of the Canon Law Society of America and as a judge and consultant for the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. On January 14, 2011, His Holiness Pope Benedict XVI appointed you as the 8th Bishop of Altoona-Johnstown. Over the past 4 years, your episcopal ministry has taken shape in many ways as you have led your priests, religious, and faithful through challenging times and brought a deepened spirit of hope and of energy to the diocese as the entire church takes up the call of the new evangelization. We honor you, too, for your gracious service to the students, staff, and faculty of St. Vincent Seminary in La Trobe, where you have been a faithful member of the Board of Regents, a consultant and advisor to the seminary administration, and a deeply appreciated and respected and admired teacher of our seminarians and faculty members alike on the topic of spiritual direction. We honor you today, Bishop Bartchak, for your generous dedication to sharing the joy of our risen Lord with your brothers and sisters in the Diocese of Altoona-Johnstown, and for your wholehearted embrace of the new evangelization. Inspired by the spirit of your patron, Saint Mark the Evangelist, may your life and labors continue to bear fruit for the Church of Altoona-Johnstown, and for all those who live by your motto, Christ, our hope of glory. In recognition of your truly outstanding leadership and service to the Diocese of Erie, to the Diocese of Altoona-Johnstown, to St. Vincent Seminary, and to the Universal Church, St. Vincent Seminary confers upon the Most Reverend Mark L. Bartchak, Bishop of Altoona-Johnstown, the degree of Doctor of Divinity honoris causa on this 8th day of May in the year of our Lord, 2015.
Good evening. It truly is an honor to be invited to give this 2015 seminary commencement address, and I'm most grateful for having been chosen to receive the honorary doctorate degree from St. Vincent Seminary. My prayerful best wishes and thanks go in a special way to a dear friend, Archabbot Douglas, to Dr. James Maher and the members of the Saint Vincent Seminary Board of Regents, with whom I am proud to serve, to Father Timothy Whalen, rector, and to the entire seminary faculty. I'd also like to say how much I appreciate the friendship and support of co-workers from the Diocese of Altoona-Johnstown, including those who were kind enough to be present this evening. Most especially, I want to offer my congratulations to the students, the seminarians, who are the real guests of honor this evening, as we recognize the completion of their academic studies and their priestly formation here at St. Vincent Seminary. In the interest of this being already a 90-degree day with heat, I'm going to cut some of the things from the talk, but I think Archabbot Douglas said it'll be published in its final and complete form. The topic for my reflections this evening, and please don't scream or cry, because Father Patrick had to emphasize that I'm a canon lawyer. The title of my address is Some Reflections on the Right and the Obligation of the Laity to Proclaim the Joy of the Gospel. It is the official teaching of the Church that the entire people of God share in the prophetic role of Jesus Christ. According to the Dogmatic Constitution on the Church, the Dogmatic Constitution on Divine Revelation, the Pastoral Constitution on the Church in the Modern World of the Second Vatican Council, all of those documents state that all the Christian faithful participate in the ministry of proclaiming the divine word. The ministry of the divine word encompasses all the ways that the mystery of God's revelation is communicated to humanity, especially in and through the mission of the Church. According to Lumen Gentium, and I quote, "Everyone in the Church has the radical right and duty to participate in the ministry of the divine word by virtue of their initiation, that is, through the sacraments of baptism, confirmation, and Holy Eucharist, by virtue of their communion with the Church, and their possession of the Spirit of Christ. In other words, we all have a role to play in evangelization. Yet young people have an openness to and a longing for an encounter with the person of Jesus Christ. As Pope Francis reminds us, this encounter with Christ is at the core of evangelization. I have come to learn that they are seeking the truth, and most of all, they are seeking love and the source of love, who is God. How do I know that? Simply because they tell me. And they tell me a lot more. And they have taught me how to dialogue with them and with their culture. This is seen especially when they boldly ask such questions phrased like this: Bishop Mark, what about gay marriage? They have taught me that the meaning of marriage is an important question for them. And it is seen especially when I'm asked a question that makes things even more personal. And it's often phrased like this: Bishop Mark, why does the Church condone gay bashing? This question is often linked to one of the realities of their culture, a personal culture when the overwhelming majority of young people will acknowledge that they know someone who is gay. They have taught me that if the response to those questions begins with a recitation of a definition of marriage according to the Catechism of the Church, it will end the conversation. They have taught me that if the initial response includes a blanket moral condemnation of homosexual persons, the conversation is over. And they have taught me that if the responses begin with a question about their hopes and fears about the question that they pose to me, then a conversation begins. By way of reminder, It's the teaching of the Second Vatican Council that the Church is to acknowledge and respond to the hopes and the fears and questions of the people of God. Young people have taught me that it would show a lack of trust in the free and unstinting activity of the Holy Spirit to think that authentic Christian values are absent, where great numbers of people have received baptism and expressed their faith in solidarity with others. In the experience of their culture, I have found that these young people often have a solidarity with others, even those who they identify as homosexual. And because they are mindful of the Catholic faith that they have received in baptism, their culture is the contemporary world with its hopes and fears and the deep changes affecting it in the social, psychological, moral, and religious dimensions described in Gaudium et Spes. These young men and women are baptized, and they try their best to discover and express their faith in solidarity with others, even at times in a bold and courageous way with their bishop. They have taught me that it is necessary to share the most important and fundamental truths of the gospel, truths like every person has a fundamental God-given dignity, and therefore they are deserving of our love and respect. It's not a concept that they keep in mind very often. And they have helped me to understand what a theologian and alumnus of Saint Vincent Seminary observed in a description of theology, especially morality, in which there is a marriage of orthodoxy, orthopraxy, together with orthopathy. In simple terms, orthodoxy has to do with right doctrine. Orthopraxy has to do with right practice. And orthopathy has to do with right affection. However, affection does not simply mean emotion. The term affection has been used in older theological discourse to describe holy and godly movements of the soul, such as love, reverence, honor, righteous anger. That theologian describes orthopathy as a cognitive and participative lens of aesthetic, emotional appreciation of the religious dimension of life that will allow our culture to experience Christianity's offer of depth, making Catholic belief and practice of fundamental pragmatic value. Young people, teenagers and young adults, have taught me that they are open to allowing their culture to experience the gospel's offer of depth and meaning. They have taught me that it is possible for a bishop to speak to them about the truth and to show them the Catholic faith and practice truly has a fundamental pragmatic value. They have taught me that even though they would more often be viewed as the ones who need to be evangelized, young Catholics can be evangelizers. I can say with certitude I would not be touched by the meaning of the gospel or encounter Jesus Christ in this way if it were not for them. According to the doctrine and the law of the Church, in virtue of their baptism and confirmation, these young people have a right and a duty to help me and you, and especially their peers, to hear the gospel and to know Jesus. For those of you who are on the threshold of new and potentially challenging and exciting ministerial experiences that follow your graduation from St. Vincent Seminary, I'd like to reiterate an observation and a specific exhortation of Pope Francis in The Joy of the Gospel. He says, "I have dealt with these topics not with the intention of providing an exhaustive treatise, but simply as a way of showing their important practical implications for the Church's mission today. All of them help give shape to a definite style of evangelization, which I ask you to adopt in every activity which you undertake." And for all of us here, including especially laypersons who have the right and the duty to proclaim the joy of the gospel, I will end with a last quote from Pope Francis. He says in the Joy of the Gospel, "I invite everyone to be bold and creative in this task of rethinking the goals, structures, style, and methods of evangelization in their respective communities. A proposal of goals without an adequate communal search for the means of achieving them will inevitably prove illusory. I encourage everyone to apply the guidelines found in this document generously and courageously, without inhibition or fear. The important thing is not to walk alone, but to rely on each other as brothers and sisters, and especially under the leadership of bishops in a wise and realistic pastoral discernment. As a bishop, I am ready to help and to receive your help, the help of laypersons, in the work of evangelization. Thank you."
Master of Divinity degree, ordination candidates. Donald Hawk Bender, Jr., Diocese of Harrisburg, cum laude. Jorge Carranza, Archdiocese of Atlanta. Ryan Fisher, Diocese of Harrisburg, summa cum laude. Zachary Gallius, Diocese of Pittsburgh, summa cum laude. Father Isaac Haywiser of the Order of Saint Benedict, Saint Vincent Archabbey, magna cum laude. Brother Peter Pham, Order of Cistercians, St. Joseph Monastery. Thomas Trocchio, Diocese of Erie. Master of Arts degree. Brother Patrick Boland of the Order of Saint Benedict, Subiaco Abbey, cum laude. Brother Joachim Morgan, Order of Saint Benedict, St. Vincent Archabbey.
Let us pray with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Almighty God, we offer these prayers to you, confident of your love for us. We offer them in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Now and forever.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.